Good afternoon, everyone. So Vital Harvest is a real estate investment trust listed on the stock exchange on the 1st of August last year. We own the largest aggregation of berries and citrus in Australia. So we have 7 farms across 3 states. These farms are all on long-term leases that's commenced in 2011 to the Costa Group, which is an ASX-listed company. We receive 2 rental streams from those leases. So we earn a 8% base rent on the historical acquisition cost, and we earn 8% on any capex that we've spent along the way or that we'll spend into the future. In addition to that, we get a 25% profit share, so the earnings off of our farms. We can get growth through capital expenditure on those farms, and we can also grow the portfolio of farms that we invest in, so new leases and new tenants. The Vital Harvest Trust is managed by GoFarm Asset Management, which is who I represent. And we declared 2 distributions through the year for a total of 5.65 cents. So I'll talk a lot about we have berry and citrus farms, but in fact we have quite a few crop types within those 2 main categories. Starting with our citrus farms, we've got 3 farms in Renmark, South Australia. They're large farms. They represent over about a quarter of the planted area of citrus in that region. That region is well known for being the premium destination for fresh citrus. So there's another citrus region in Australia closer to Mildura, and they're known for their juicing citrus. So with our footprint here, we have, as I said, a quarter of the footprint, but we have very large farms, so almost 2,000 hectares. The average citrus farm in Australia is about 20 hectares, so they're quite unique assets. And this region also enjoys fruit fly free pest status, which makes it unique, and that status allows us to get into export markets. We get our water from these properties out of the Murray River, and I'll talk a little bit more about the water later. Citrus trees last for a long time, as do avocado trees. So in addition to citrus, we have avocados, persimmons, and wine grapes, though the majority of our crop is oranges and mandarins. They take a long time to get to yield. And in the past few years, we've been spending a lot of money on new plantings and top working to get production up. And over 20% of our trees are yet to reach production. So to put a little context around that, a mandarin tree at 11 years will be producing 60 tons per hectare. But in the first few years, we'll produce nothing. Maybe by the 3rd or 4th year, 3 to 5 tons, and then it'll go up from there. So we have a fair bit of run rate ahead of us. In addition to the citrus, we've got a portfolio of 4 berry farms. The largest by far is up at Corindi, which is just north of Coffs Harbour. Up there, we've got blueberries, raspberries, and blackberries. Further down from there at Tumbarumba, at southern New South Wales, at higher altitude and colder climate, we've got blueberries. And then down in Tasmania, again, in the colder climate, we have blueberries on one farm and blackberries on the other farm. We have that geographic diversity so that we can assist in getting fruit to market for a longer period throughout the year. So we do pick raspberries year-round, and we're able to do that because our raspberries are planted in substrate rather than in soil. So what that means is that they're planted in a pot with a material around it that has no nutrients of its own, and so the raspberry gets all of its food and water needs through the fertigation system. So a bit like a glasshouse environment, we put a tunnel over the top and protect it from the elements, and we grow to optimum growing conditions. That means that we get fruit faster, we get more of it, more consistent fruit. Because we've had such success with raspberries in substrate, about a third of our blueberries have now gone into substrate with the same benefits, protected cropping. And also a little bit of our raspberries as well. We've spent a fair bit on CapEx, particularly in that soil to substrate conversion over the life of our leases, just increasing the yield that we get off of our footprint. Important to understand with our business is how is the rent paid. So I talked about having two streams. We have a base rent component, and that's paid monthly in advance. That's the 8% on the historical acquisition cost plus the CapEx. That current cost base is $117 million. We have a reset clause in our leases, so our tenant can extend the leases for a further 10 years when we get to the end of the initial 15-year term. So that term comes up in 2026. If the tenant wishes to exercise the option, the base rent is reset to 8% of an independent market valuation. So for context, we're providing the current market valuation, which is $267 million. So 8% of that is 21.4 mil. So that would be quite the uplift from today's 9.4. And in addition to that, we would continue to receive the variable or profit share component. So moving on to that profit share component, so 25% of the earnings from operations on our farms comes to us as a variable rent. We calculate that on a 12-month basis. So for a cash flow point of view, our tenant will give us actuals from January to June and forecasts from July to December. Take the two numbers together, divide by two, and give us a payment right about this time of year for the first half. Then when we get to the end of December, they'll have actuals for 12 months, subtract what they paid us at the halfway point, and pay the balance. And if the tenant is good at forecasting, those numbers should be roughly equal. I don't know how to go backwards on here. I've gone too far. Red one. So the last point I'll just make on that is that we have one calculation for that profit share for the citrus category, one calculation for the berry category. We do not share in losses, so that calculation can never be zero, and they don't offset each other. So if there was a poor performance in one category, it doesn't offset a good performance in the other category, and it's reset on an annual basis. And this chart shows us about the history of the rental revenue. So the dark green is our fixed rent component, and you can see that it's growing each year. It's expected to grow into the future. The green is the profit share of the variable rent. It does have more variableness to it. In large part, particularly around that FY18 year, is the timing of the citrus crop. So citrus is harvested from around April through September, but in a bell-shaped curve. And so that bell-shaped curve really hits the crux in June, July, August. And Mother Nature can bring forward that harvest a few weeks, 2, 3, 4 weeks. It can also push it back 2, 3, 4 weeks. And for an accounting treatment, we have to draw a line in the sand on 30th June. And sometimes that means that we have a shift when we recognize the citrus. So FY18 had the benefit at the beginning of the year of a late harvest and at the end of the year of an early harvest. FY19 has had, so at the beginning of the year, it suffered from having an early harvest, and at the end of the year, it suffered from having a late harvest. But all the fruit is still on those trees, so we've only harvested at 30 June 25% of the crop. So 75% of the crop is coming through in this next half. We did also have some headwinds, particularly in the berry category this year just gone. So mainly driven around blueberry prices. So if you've been to the supermarket in the last few days, you'll have seen that you can get berries maybe for $2.50 a punnet, which is about as cheap as you'll ever see at this time of year. Normally that's a summertime price. And that's just a reflection of more fruit coming on the market at this stage. We do expect that to ease as we are enjoying increasing demand from Australian consumers. The other issue we had in the berries was an instance that the tenant had. So they had a crumbly fruit issue in their raspberries. So if you look at a raspberry, it is a cluster, and when you pick that cluster, it's falling apart in the punnet. And when you go to the supermarkets, don't want to see that. And the consumers don't want to see a raspberry that has fallen apart. The tenant has identified the issue there and have put plans into place to fix that. So it's fixable. It'll just take a little bit of time. In terms of capital expenditure, we have spent about $38 million in capital expenditure since the lease has commenced, on averaging about $5 million a year. We spent a little less in FY19, but since the 30th of June, we've actually spent a bit more. We settled on an additional Berry property in July. So looking at where we go from here, within the different categories, we have citrus, which has strong volumes expected, particularly for that upcoming harvest. So as I mentioned, 75% of fruit still to pick. We have a little bit of fruit fly that impacted one small portion of one of our farms that came from Victoria. There'll be an extra cost to treat that fruit, which is about 17% of the fruit. And we have higher water allocation costs due to the ongoing drought conditions across the Murray-Darling Basin. Water being a bit of a double-edged sword, as we own a lot of water entitlements, about two-thirds of our annual needs. And those water entitlements have been going up greatly in value, and that has helped our balance sheet. But the one-third that we don't own has temporary water prices at higher than previous seasons. Berry consumption, again, is on the up, so still lagging North American consumption, but we're expecting 20% growth in blueberries and 40% growth in raspberries. We've got some pressure on the pricing with blueberries, as I mentioned, and the crumbly fruit issues, which is one variety of our raspberries. Approximately one-third of our raspberries have that issue, and of that one-third, approximately one-third are crumbling. So when I mentioned the water before, we have water that is distinctly different between the berry and the citrus portfolio. So within the berries, it's not a river system, it's a catchment. So in rainfall, we collect and harvest and store in dams on site, and we have very strong water security there. On the citrus, we take water out of the Murray-Darling Basin. And as I mentioned, our two-thirds of our needs are covered by our high security water entitlements. So on that graph, at the green dot, is what our water was valued at the time of the IPO. Water prices have gone up 46% since the IPO, so we've had quite the uplift there. We do have some challenges there in terms of government buying back water. That's what's helping with our water prices, as well as the current drought conditions. I might mention briefly, we did have the CapEx. I'm down to just over a minute and a half, so I'll try and get through this quickly. We've got, as I said, organic capital expenditure. We expect to continue off the properties. Soil to substrate conversions, or in that picture there is some permanent netting we've put over some of our citrus properties. And we also will be looking for opportunities to grow the portfolio, so new leases and new tenants. Focusing particularly on horticulture, fruits, nuts, and vegetables are our preference, and we think where we have a distinct advantage. I'll quickly run you through financial results. So this is being our first year listed, has represents only 11-month period, and it also includes all of our IPO costs. So we had rental revenue for the 11 months of $15.4 million. Of that, 8.5 was base rent and 6.8 was variable rent. As I mentioned previously, we did do two distributions through the year for a total of 5.65 cents. This slide explains our net asset value. So in Australian accounting terms, water is an intangible asset. So when you get look at an NTA of 69 cents, you then need to add on the intangible assets, but water can only ever be valued under those standards at cost or below. So cost price is 21 cents, that brings our NAV to 90 cents. And then we had Colliers value the water for us at 30 June, and they said, well, that it's actually worth 14 cents more. So that brings us to $1.04. And that brings me to the end of my time. Thank you.